Okay, so folks, I'm Joe Lombardo. I'm the co-coordinator of United National Anti War Coalition. And the title of this panel is Democrats and Republicans, the Twin Parties of Imperialist War. We were meant to have four panelists. One of them pulled out his back and couldn't get here from California, and that's Jeff Mackler. So at the end, I might say a couple of words in his place. The other panelist, and I'll introduce them more as
he was just on Skype on another panel to be on Skype.
We thought about that. We talked about it and said, just do BB. So we have Jamal Baraka. Will be speaking. We have Margaret Kimberly will be speaking, and Abiyomi Zikwe, and I will give them a fuller introduction as they come up and speak. But the first speaker has to be Margaret Kimberly, who is member of the UNAC Administrative Committee, an editor and senior columnist for Black Agenda Report. And she's first because she has a conflict with another panel. So she's going to speak here first and then speak there later, so we won't have the benefit of her during the question and discussion period. But the rest of us will be here. So let's start with Margaret and go down the line.
Thank you. Thank you all, and I thank everybody for their forbearance that I can't stay, and I apologize to the rest of the panelists who I would love to hear. So good afternoon, everybody. I'm going to start by saying I found it hard to put these remarks together about foreign policy, and I'm going to blame Donald Trump, I'm blaming for everything, but also, there's so many contradictions with Trump and that are pretty significant. So I'm hoping to be coherent. But anyway, you know, Trump is, he's a Republican. He's certainly on the right. He won by the Electoral College victory by appealing to white national sentiment, that is to say racism. Putting America first was clearly understood to mean put white people first. And I was surprised by the degree of my success. I think that should have been. I think that calling for a wall on the Mexican border probably won him the presidency before I was paying attention. But he also, and this is a difficulty that I have in talking about him sometimes, he also said things that made him enemies among some of the ruling class. For example, trade deals. Such as TPP and NAFTA. He said he'll be negotiating, who knows. But that is messing with the money of the 1%. Helping capitalists move their capital is an unquestioned goal of US foreign policy. At least it was until he came along. So was continuing war by other means against Russia and attempting Russia to capitulate and cede power to America and give up some of its sovereignty. So these things present problems for foreign policy orthodoxy. On the other hand, he stands firmly with the continuity of U.S. foreign policy. It was just about 2 months ago that he attacked Syria with the missile strike. The case was cooked up, of course, gas attacks carried out by terrorist forces in Syria, and it was used to bring him back into line when he said that regime change might not be a goal of foreign policy. Carving it up maybe, but not regime change. But anyway, you see how hard this all can be. So the Democrats would have us believe that Trump is completely antithetical to them, that his administration is some low point for democracy and they want nothing to do with him or his policies. But what did they say when he attacked Syria with those missiles? Some, like Hillary Clinton, openly praised him. They said it was the right thing to do. Others waffled. Some said he should have gone to Congress first to ask permission. Now, they didn't say they would have opposed him. They just said he should have asked first. And I actually wish he had, because then they would have had to go on record as to where they stood. The war party is completely bipartisan. There are no Democrats or Republicans. when it comes to upholding hegemony and imperialism around the globe. Let's look at recent history. We have to go back and talk about Obama a bit. He was credited with being the anti-war candidate when he first ran in 2008. And that was so plainly, clearly untrue. And the fact that the corporate media let him get away with making that claim is proof that he was the choice of the leader all along. In fact, he said when he was asked, have you been in the Senate for the vote on the war with Iraq, what have you done? And he said he didn't know. He said he wasn't against all wars, just dumb wars. He never made it clear what made a war dumb or not, but it was a signal that he was gonna uphold all the prerogatives of US imperialism. And when he won his undeserved Nobel Peace Prize, he used his speech to talk about why war is necessary. So he, yes, he did say that war is peace. So fast forward to 2017, and what did we witness during his presidency? Apparently he concluded that dumb wars were those that didn't involve sending Americans. He didn't send US soldiers to Libya or to attempt to destroy Syria. He used the tried and true method of sending jihadists backed by Gulf monarchies like Saudi Arabia. He used the color revolution in Ukraine to bring neo-Nazis to power to threaten and provoke Russians. So George W. Bush, if you can remember that far back, said he wasn't in favor of nation building or regime change either. And he certainly didn't remember he said those words or and invaded Iraq. Obama never used that word, regime change. He talked about the responsibility to protect and made the claim that Libyans and Syrians wanted their countries to be destroyed. So along comes Trump, who said he didn't want regime change either. He does say things like we should do something, whatever that means, about Iran and China and North Korea. But Trump is never clear what he means or what he wants. He did say repeatedly he wanted better relations with Russia. He said that often enough, but we don't know exactly what that means. And in any case now, those words are pretty worthless because his overtures to Russia have been used to claim that Vladimir Putin somehow handed him the presidency. But Trump is like his predecessors and offers more continuity. And we saw that on his recent trip, foreign trip last week in Saudi Arabia. He went to Saudi Arabia, to Israel, and the NATO and G7 summits in Europe. And it was interesting when he was in Saudi Arabia, we saw how little the elites like him and how much they still depend on Obama. Trump announced an arms sale, $100 billion arms sale to Saudi Arabia, which is roughly the same amount of arms selling that Obama did with Saudi Arabia. And those weapons have been used against Yemen since 2015 in this horrible genocidal war. The bombing, the blockade of Yemen has resulted in starvation and a cholera epidemic. But according to, among others, Obama's friends at the New York Times, the president, former president, didn't really want this to happen. They had an editorial entitled, "Will Trump Save Yemen?" And they implored him, Trump, to undo what Obama did without any complaint from them. They made no reference to Obama's forgiveness. I don't know if you remember, he went on a state visit to India and cut the visit short, because the past king of Saudi Arabia had passed away. So he goes running to Saudi Arabia just to make sure that all those ducks are still in a row. So they're America's partners in crime, and they still are. And it was almost funny, even Samantha Power, who was his UN ambassador, she went on Twitter criticizing the Saudis, and for some reason thought nobody in social media was gonna notice, but people took her to task, and I'm glad that she did. But here's Obama, he's still being trotted out to meet with world leaders. So first he endorsed the new president of France, Macron, which is something we're not supposed to do. It's such a terrible thing to be involved in the politics of another country, but he endorsed him, he met him, he made a commercial for him. And last week, he made a public appearance with Angela Merkel in Germany. Now it wasn't called a campaign appearance, but clearly that's what it was. So the former president is more a favorite of some among the 1% than the current president. So it all can be confusing, but some things are still very clear. Trump was at the NATO summit, and the only thing that most Americans know is that he shoved the president of Montenegro out of the way. But the important things to which I don't want anybody shoving me out of the way, so I don't want to excuse that, but I think it's important to say that NATO is not some august institution that ought to be revered. It's an enemy of peace, and works hand in hand. It is America's outpost of imperialism in Europe. When the Soviets stood down, when Gorbachev just unilaterally removed troops from Eastern Germany, remember we were supposed to have a peace dividend or something? Well, that didn't happen. So all we got was an expansion of NATO to the former Soviet allies. And when Libya was destroyed, it was always felt in solidarity with, until they were in Obama's crosshairs, and then everybody forgot. But at any rate, after the dirty deed was done, the then Prime Minister of the UK, then President of France, went to Libya personally to gloat and to dance with Gaddafi's grave. So I have my own reasons, many reasons, for not liking Trump, but the fact that NATO has collected knows out of joint about him is not among my concerns. And that brings me to another important point. I think it's a mistake to focus so much on Trump that we become confused. It doesn't matter to me if NATO was weak. Why is it a problem for NATO to be weak? Or Angela Merkel says, we're going to have to go to go, and we can't trust America anymore. Well, so what? I don't see that as being a problem. Now, I'm not like, this is the odd thing about Trump. He may say some part of something that I've said, not ever for the same reason. I don't see NATO nations as dead people who don't pay their dues. That's certainly not my concern. But my concern is that these imperial alliances fall apart. So I think when all is said and done, we have to stay our course, no matter who in the duopoly happens to be in power. Because the goals of US foreign policy never change. We have to oppose intervention all the time, and uphold the doctrine of sovereignty of all nations. And that can sometimes be difficult to do because there are people who deliberately confuse us. For example, I have no problem at all defending President Assad of Syria and his right to defend his country from attack, from the US, from NATO, from the Saudis, from Turkey, from Israel, from ISIS. Did I leave anybody out? And of course, we're told he's a butcher. And I love how they make up these words for anybody the US government doesn't like, and they're trying to make us not like them also. No American president's ever called a butcher. No American allies ever called a butcher. These words exist just for people that our government is trying to crush. I think invading Iraq and killing a million people ought to qualify George W. Bush for butcherhood or butcherosity or whatever you want to call it. We can't be confused when the US put neo-Nazis in power in Ukraine. Imagine, suppose Canada or Mexico had a political crisis and Vladimir Putin chose sides and put his party in power. Would that be okay with any American president? Of course, the answer is no. So that's something to keep in mind when we're told he's evil and even blah, 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 blah. And lastly, I want to talk about the corporate media and the role they play in upholding this system. Much of is being made these days about the term fake news, which, as far as I can tell, is what we've always been exposed to. The Gulf of Tonkin resolution was fake news. When Colin Powell went to the UN in 2003 and allegedly made some bogus case that there was WMD in Iraq, that was fake news, and the cheerleading from the corporate media, from the New York Times and Washington Post, was fake news. Barack Obama hasn't shut up about fake news since election night. And that's because of the way Trump changed things. His victory threatened the system in some of the ways I've discussed, but it was a result of elite consensus being delegitimized. And that's a threat to the 1% and to the corporate media. We have other sources of information, so they have to tell us not to listen to them. And that's why the Washington Post recently the Chigs are masked, I think only online, it says democracy dies in darkness, as if the Washington Post really believes in democracy. That's why they have to put up a front group, propaganda or not, to discredit voices like those of us at Black Agenda Report. But you can't talk about them without mentioning that the Post's sole owner is Jeff Bezos, the founder of Amazon, which has a $600 million contract with the CIA. And he's one of the richest people on the planet, one of those eight people whose net worth totals the same as the net worth of the poorest people on the planet. So this isn't someone who's going to give us anything but fake news. And I point this out because we can't fight against imperialist wars without calling attention to how they get popular support. There are millions of Syrian refugees because of the United States. They weren't leaving their country en masse until the Human Change effort began. But are we ever told that in corporate media? Do they ever tie Obama's name to this humanitarian crisis or to the refugee crisis in Libya that sends people across the Mediterranean Sea and to some African migrants into slavery, which I have not yet seen in the American newspaper. I've seen it in The Guardian, I've seen it in other places. I have not seen mention of that. If somebody else has, please let me know. But the crimes are hidden in plain sight by their lies, and it's our job to expose them. And to stand firm against the continued violation of human rights around the world by the United States, whether the person in the White House has a D or an R behind the scenes. Thank you very much.
Margaret, because she's going to not be able to participate in the discussion anyway, but everybody else will grant time for 12 minutes, if that's okay with everybody, and then we will have some discussion at the end. I also want to point your attention to the table. There is some UNAC literature, including a flyer for our conference, which will be held, our next national conference, which will be held in Richmond, Virginia, on the weekend of the 16th through the 18th of June, so in about 2 weeks. And if you can get down there, I urge you to do it. It's our first attempt to do something in what some people consider the South, because we've had a growth of some organizations that have been working with UNAC in the South. So we hope it will be a successful conference, and I urge you to go. Our next speaker is going to be Abiyomi Ezekwe, who is from the Pan-African Newswire. He is a founding member of the Michigan Emergency Committee Against War and Injustice. He is also a member of the Administrative Committee of UNAC.
Well, thank you so much. Hello. Thank everyone for coming out to this panel. This is a very broad topic. I want to focus somewhat on United States foreign policy towards Africa since World War II to show the continuity of imperialist policies carried out by both the Democratic and the Republican Party just since World War II. And the only way you can do that, you have to select certain countries to focus on because we could be here all night. Discussing this topic. It is so vast. There's so much intervention and there's such a profound history of it from Washington as well as Wall Street. Now, these developments do not take place in a vacuum. So I just want to touch on very briefly some of the other consistent U.S. foreign policy imperatives that impact other geopolitical regions. Now, with the ascendancy of President Donald Trump to the White House, a strong focus has been placed by his critics on his role as a promoter of racism, national oppression inside the United States, but also warmongering abroad. Now, just recently we've observed the escalation of tensions in the Korean Peninsula with the placement of the Terminal High Altitude Area Defense System, missile system, TAD. People have heard of that, of course. The president's posture in relationship to the government of the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, commonly known in the United States as North Korea, just several weeks ago threatening the full resumption of an unresolved war in that area of the world. There's never been a peace treaty between the United States and the DPRK. There's an armistice agreement that was signed in 1953. So technically, the U.S. Ruling class is still at war with the DPRK. Now, there's been increasing aerial attacks against purported, and I say purported, al-Qaeda targets in Yemen. When Trump came in, of course, he ordered, well, he supposedly was ordered before he came in. It was carried out under him a commando raid on a village in Yemen that killed a number of people and also resulted in the death of a U.S. Navy SEAL. While at the same time, the people in Yemen, which is the most underdeveloped state in the Middle East, is suffering immensely from a Pentagon-coordinated war that involves Saudi Arabia and the Gulf Cooperation Council. They've been bombing the country daily since March of 2015. An estimated 12,000 people have been killed. Now, these are official estimates. Some people say it's a lot more. And it's prompted widespread outbreaks of cholera that's impacted officially some 60,000 people in Yemen. Outrageous, completely. Now, Trump goes to Saudi Arabia recently and, of course, says nothing about the suffering of the people in Yemen. The Saudi officials talk about Iranian influence in Yemen. This is their basis for intervention. Trump has identified the Islamic Republic of Iran as a principal enemy in the region. And at the same time, you see in the corporate media this whole issue not even being covered. For example, about 2 days ago, I read an Associated Press article that mentioned a Saudi Arabian campaign in Yemen. Said nothing about the aerial bombardments, said nothing about the Qatari special forces that have been deployed there. It said absolutely nothing about the forces that back the ousted president, Hadi, ground forces that are operating particularly in southern Yemen. So there's a total effort to hide, you know, the atrocities that are being committed in Yemen, which is right across the Gulf of Aden from the Horn of Africa. There African people in Yemen who have been there for thousands and thousands of years. Also, the deployment of the massive ordnance air blasts, MOAB, commonly known as the mother of all bombs in Afghanistan several weeks ago, represented a new level of warfare in that Central African country, which has been the focus of U.S. foreign policy at least since 1979, when the Islamist forces, who they say now are their enemies, were funded and unleashed against the Soviet-backed socialist-oriented government that was in power in Afghanistan. You don't hear too much about that in the media, that U.S. imperialism supported the so-called Mujahideen in Afghanistan beginning in the late 1970s through the 1980s, and would visit the United States under the Reagan administration and be praised as freedom fighters, as proponents of democracy, just as the Contras in Nicaragua and the UNITA bandits in Angola. So these are some of the developments that have been taking place. The United States has had ground troops in Afghanistan for nearly 16 years with no end in sight whatsoever. Not even a discussion about withdrawing from Afghanistan. Obama said he was withdrawing combat troops from there, but he said the thousands upon thousands of troops that are there, CIA personnel, military trainers, private contractors, are there in an advisory and a training capacity. Yet, occasionally you do hear about U.S. forces being killed in Afghanistan. Now, I want to get to the African continent. I want to just talk about four countries very briefly. Now, although the Trump administration's foreign policy towards Africa has gained far less attention by the Western media, there's been a continuation of the already existing hostilities on the African continent. Somalia, in the Horn of Africa, oil-rich nation, been suffering immensely over the last several decades. Trump singled out Somalia. The escalation of Pentagon and Central Intelligence Agency personnel were stationed in this Horn of Africa state, saying he was, quote, lifting the, quote, restraint that had been imposed by Barack Obama in regard to U.S. forces in Somalia. There was no restraint under the previous administration. They fund the African Union mission to Somalia, some 22,000 troops, They helped train them. Since 2007, they've been involved in bombing campaigns in Somalia that killed innocent civilians under the guise of fighting against Al-Qaeda and ISIS-linked terrorists. A special forces soldier was killed by Al-Shabaab guerrilla units just several weeks ago while they were embedded in the U.S. and European Union-backed Somali National Army. Came out, even in the corporate media, that this Navy SEAL that was killed was actually on a maneuver against Al-Shabaab with the Somali National Army. Now, although the administration claims that it was doing away with the supposed restrictions on military activities in Somalia by former President Barack Obama, interventions by the U.S. in Somalia go back as far as the late 1970s, when it encouraged an invasion by the government of the then President Mohamed Siad Barre against the Ogaden region of Ethiopia, where the Somali population are a majority in that area. Another Democratic presidential incumbent at that time was Jimmy Carter, when all this went on in 1978. He was in the Oval Office at that time. During the waning days of the presidential tenure of George H.W. Bush, Sr., it was marked by the invasion of 12,000 Marines in Somalia in a failed, what they call, Operation Restore Hope that began in December of 1992. This was a plan that was inherited by Bill Clinton when he came in office in January of 1993, which ended in disaster when people rose up against the occupation. They made a movie called Black Hawk Down. Well, that was just a sensationalistic portrayal of what actually happened. I mean, it was very fierce urban guerrilla warfare resistance to U.S. forces. Yeah, since 2007, the U.S., then under President George W. Bush Jr., has encouraged and sponsored the intervention into Somalia national affairs by contiguous states in the Horn of Africa. First, by seeking to empower warlords to subvert the efforts of the Union of Islamic Courts. That was in 2006, and then later, encouraging the Ethiopian military, which is now allied with the United States, to intervene, which they did in 2007. And then after 2009, where they split the Union of Islamic Courts, some of them were brought into the interim federal regime in Somalia, Washington sought to guide the forces against this war-rich state. Now, several neighboring states have been drawn into the African Union mission to Somalia, Amazon, which now has approximately 22,000 troops. These troops come from Kenya, Ethiopia, Djibouti, where the U.S. has an AFRICOM base stationed in Djibouti with thousands of U.S. troops, as French troops are also there as well. And they also utilized for the war against Yemen, Burundi, which is in eastern part of Central Africa, and Uganda, which has also played a major role with the United States over the last two decades in U.S. militarist policies, principally in East and Central Africa. They have police officers there from Ghana, Sierra Leone, and Nigeria, and they're also a part of this same mission. Moving on, in the Southern African nation of Zimbabwe, since 1998, the former British colonial power, the United States, the European Union, among others, have imposed draconian sanctions on the government there. The government is headed by the Zimbabwe African National Union Patriotic Front. President Robert Mugabe has been in power there since 1980, when in 2000, the Parliament of Zimbabwe passed legislation granting the right of the indigenous African people to radically redistribute land to the people. The sanctions and other forms of hostile propaganda were enacted. The whole struggle in Zimbabwe was for the reclaiming of the land, which was stolen during the latter part of the 19th century by people such as Cecil Rhodes and the mining firms, gold and diamond mining firms in Zimbabwe. They also have platinum there. It's a very rich nation, but it's been strangled economically because they dared to take millions and millions of hectares of land from the white British settlers. Now, both Britain and the United States attempted to persuade the Republic of South Africa when Thabo Mbeki was in office to impose a blockade on Zimbabwe, which they absolutely refused to do because Zimbabwe is basically a landlocked state. Britain drew up plans for an evacuation of its settler population, which held, they also held UK passports, so that Zimbabwean citizens, ostensibly, They owned most of the land inside the country, but at the same time, they still held British passports. Just think about that. Okay, now, these suggestions failed through the assistance of successive African National Congress governments in South Africa, the support of the regional Southern African Development Community, which refused to condemn Zimbabwe, and the People's Republic of China, the country which has supplied a lot of assistance to Zimbabwe, and they have been able to remain afloat over the last 17 years. Now, this, of course, was not the case in the North African nation of Libya, where under the Jim Harriet system, headed by Colonel Muammar Gaddafi, the oil-rich country had attained the highest standard of living of anywhere on the African continent. It was the Democratic administration of Barack Obama, with Hillary Clinton as Secretary of State, which coordinated a war of regime change and genocide that destroyed Libya as a viable state, and later captured and brutally murdered by imperialist agents on October 20th of 2011. Today, Libya is a major source of instability and human trafficking internationally. Thousands have died off the coast of the country in the Mediterranean in attempts to flee the chaos and the impoverishment which now characterizes the country. There are at least three identifiable governments in Libya, which often engage in deadly military struggles for political and economic authority. We just saw what happened in Tripoli several days ago. The country has gone from Africa's most prosperous to dire poverty and balkanization due to imperialist intervention. Numerous attempts by counter-revolutionary elements backed by the White House, European Union member states, and the United Nations to form a viable regime has failed over the last 6 years. So these are just two examples, and we can get into more examples during the question and answer period, but clearly, we have Republican administrations, Democratic administrations that are advancing the same imperialist policy in Africa, even under John F. Kennedy, who's considered a liberal, who is, lionized today. He was the first chair of the subcommittee of the Senate Foreign Subcommittee on Africa of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. He began the that committee in 1959, positioning himself to run for president in 1960. So we can discuss this during the question and answer. Thank you for your attention.
Next speaker is Jamal Baraka, who is a longtime human rights activist. Most recently, he ran as vice presidential candidate for the Green Party, and he's now involved in a very exciting project. He's organizing a group called the Black Alliance for Peace. I think everybody who's conscious understands that anti-war sentiment in the Black community has always been the highest. And the question is to organize that sentiment into a force that can help make a change. And so this project is a very significant project, in my opinion. Recently, UNAC and the Black Alliance did a joint statement on Venezuela, which you can see on the table here if you'd like to pick it up. This is John Brown.
Thank you. I appreciate that introduction. I appreciate all of you being here this afternoon. I thank UNAC for allowing me to be a part of this panel, especially with my dear brother here, who's been in the trenches for such a long time and bringing such quality information to us for such a long time. It's an honor to be sharing this panel with him also, and with my my comments will be relatively simple and to the point. I think the argument has been laid out, the evidence presented, that both parties are equally implicated in terms of the advancement of U.S. imperialism and the systematic support given by the U.S. state to the oligarchy in the United States of America. And that reality, those politics, have been reflective of the politics of both political parties. as your brother just laid out in terms of Africa and a couple of other examples like Yemen, is that fairly consistent that the U.S. Has used its military means to advance its interests. Now, there are differences at different points in history, but let's talk about that for a moment. After the end of the Second Imperialist War, the Second World War as we know it, we know that the U.S. emerged as the most powerful nation in the West. Had the opportunity to become the leader of the Pan-European project, meaning that project of Western European states, including the U.S., that had risen to dominance over the course of the last, at that point, about 400-something years, beginning in 1492 with the invasion of the Americas, a process that resulted in the creation of what we call the West. And that process resulted in economic development of the so-called West, and the economic, political, cultural, social underdevelopment of all of the nations that ended up colonized by Europe. That history created the material disparity between the West and the rest, okay? But because of their own internal contradictions, their inability to come to terms with the competition among themselves, among the various empires, the inability to transcend the crisis of 1873, and their attempt to try to address that crisis by engaging in more aggressive colonialism, including attempting to try to make sure that could be done effectively with the Berlin Conference, where they carved up the African continent. We know that they failed. And by the turn of the 20th century, they were engulfed in capitalist, imperialist war among themselves. That resulted in the configurations of states that emerged after the First World War. The peace that came out, the so-called peace that came out of that process, didn't last long because of the contradictions of capital and imperialism had not been resolved. They were just set aside. They took new forms. We had the Russian Revolution, the emergence of the Soviet Union, that came out of the vacuum that was created, came out of the chaos of the contradictions of capital and capitalism. By the 1920s, you had now another worldwide recession. And you had, in response to that, instead of revolutionary change that was being predicted by many, by revolutionary theory, you had instead at the beginning of the rise of fascism that led to, of course, the war, the Second Imperialist War, in which the Western nations allowed for the Nazis to rearm with the intent that they were going to allow the Nazis to do the business they had attempted right after the Russian Revolution, and that is to do away with the Soviet Union. But of course, Hitler had other plans, and of course, as part of the appeasement process, he moved west, kept on moving west until he dominated most of Western Europe. At that point, then he made his fatal error in attempting to then move to the east and move against the Soviet Union, and we know the history. Basically, as a consequence of the Soviet peoples and the tremendous price that they paid, the Nazi regime and fascism was temporarily defeated at that point. The U.S. had laid back in the back for a while until they saw that there was going to be an opening and were able to maneuver themselves into the Second World War when they instigated the conflict with the Japanese that then gave them the opening to then declare war on the Germans so they can get into the mix, anticipating that there was going to be a possibility that the Germans would be defeated and they would emerge as a predominant power, which of course is what happened. At the end of that war, you had the U.S. emerging as the most powerful nation. All of the other European nations were fundamentally wounded, unable to completely hold their colonies, but they attempted to do that. They attempted to try to hold some of those colonies with the assistance of the U.S., but the price they had to pay was that they had to allow the U.S. to basically sort of take charge, also penetrate those economies and to control those people. Domestically, there was a compromise with the U.S. emerging as the most powerful nation on this planet. There was the very famous labor capital compromise in which the agitation, the organizing that was taking place right before the war somewhat dissipated to some extent because now we had the good old days. We had the end of the war, we had the possibility of new prosperity, but the deal was that you would not engage in too militant of activities to attempt to dislodge and displace capital. And what you would get in return would be massive investments in new housing, roads that allow for the working class to begin to emerge as the new so-called middle class. Went out to the suburbs, they left the urban areas. Those areas, of course, were pretty filled by the second great migration of migrants from the south that went into those territories. So it was a good old days. You know, we saw the TV programs in the 1950s, 60s, the Beaver, and all of those kind of programs where things were really, really nice. But for the vast majority of black people, it wasn't a good old days. Basically, part of the compromise was that you know, beyond not opposing capital too aggressively, part of the compromise was that they were supposed to allow for segregation to continue. That we were going to be once again sacrificed. But we had our own plan. That after the Second World War, primarily under the leadership of many people came back from that conflict, you had the human rights movement. The radical black human rights movement in the U.S. You had the National Negro Congress and the Civil Rights Congress. You had the NAACP that saw that the end of the war and the beginning of this new structure called the UN and the new configuration of power because not only did the U.S. emerge as a dominant power, they weren't the only power. You had the Soviet Union and the so-called Eastern Bloc that was developing. So you had countervailing power there, which provided some political space for activists in the U.S. and other places. And radical black activists saw that and began to agitate for the end of racial oppression in the U.S., but also they agitated for ending colonialism. And that's what they, in fact, did. In the 1950s, that struggle intensified. It took the form in the beginning of the civil rights struggles for democratic rights in the South. And so that upset the sort of agreement because that struggle then, of course, you know, bled into the North because that's where the majorities of African people were beginning to concentrate. And, you know, the relative peaceful civil rights movement began to morph into a more militant and aggressive resistance that we have come to classify as a black liberation movement. A movement that was concerned not only with advanced in the interest of black people, but also it was a movement that understood that we had a common enemy, with people around the world, and that common enemy was the imperialist capitalist system. And that the conclusion was reached that the only way we're going to be able to advance our interests, our fundamental democratic rights, was that we had to do away with that system. So that upset the apple cart because we went to war, and they went to war on us. And we began to demand more. We weren't going to allow ourselves to be walled up into these ghettos. We weren't going to allow for ourselves to be shipped off to these various wars, fighting for them when we had no democratic rights in the U.S. And we that was a very powerful opposition, because we know that one of the consequences of the U.S. emerging as this powerful nation after the Second World War was that in order to maintain its hegemony and to expand the influence of the West, they were involved in constant conflict, constant war. As we all know, that, you know, beginning under both Democrats and Republicans, the Korean War, the Vietnam War, the intervention in Iran, Guatemala, Indonesia, I mean, it goes on, Dominican Republic, it goes on and on, all of the military dictatorships that they imposed throughout Latin America, the anti-colonial fights that they were involved in. They sided with the colonists against African people who were fighting for liberation. You know, the assassination of Lumumba, the balkanization of the African continent, the coup against Kwame Nkrumah. It is a blood-dripping history that this country is responsible for. And the result was that basically we have these contradictions. So this notion that the Democrats have been solved for war is a myth. This idea that what we're facing today is something that's new, it basically has no basis in reality. That what we have today is a continuation of this bloody history. But we have a new situation in that we all know the Soviet Union was collapsed, or collapsed, depending on how you looked at it. And that countervailing power was no longer in place. We had a new aggressive policy emerging in the 1990s. And the centerpiece of that was full spectrum dominance. And that strategy of full spectrum dominance, that is for the ruling class in this country to be committed to maintaining their hegemony by any means necessary, was a policy embraced by both political parties. The only difference was that, for example, the Obama administration brought the smiling face of imperialism, soft power, and today you have the cruel power of Donald Trump. And the difference with Donald Trump, though, is that, you know, he's been, you know, saying some things that were undercutting their strategy, and that's one of the reasons why the ruling class mobilized to delegitimize his presidency. But my time is up. I see Joe squirming. And so I'm going to end it here, and we can get into this more during the Q&A. Thank you.
I'll just say a couple of brief remarks, and then we'll get into the question and discussion period. I think the other speakers made it clear that these imperialist wars have continued under both administrations of Republicans and Democrats, that both parties are parties of war, that war is basically a bipartisan issue in this country. In fact, it's partly the reason that UNAC was formed, because we understood that there was a need to have an independent movement, independent of these parties. When Obama was elected, a lot of the anti-war movement thought we were in a new era, that there was going to be peace. In any case, it's difficult to protest against the first black president. And so the anti-war movement kind of dissipated. From leaders of the previous coalition that existed in this country, the war coalition, I actually heard right after the election of Obama, before he took the reins of office, at the last conference that that particular coalition held was that they had heard that Obama was going to have a new cabinet position, would be the Office of Peace, and that some of them might be considered for that position.
Pieces, maybe.
I told them I didn't think so. But what did happen was the movement dissipated. The wars didn't end. And so some people got together at a conference up in Albany of 800 people and decided we need to continue with the anti-war movement. It's been a tough haul. It was very tough to do that. But the wars have continued. The wars have expanded. There's been continuous war. And it's very important to have an anti-war movement and to let the other movements that have been developing in the community, against the militarization of the police, against the mass incarceration, against the expulsion of immigrants from the country. And so it's important for there to be an independent anti-war voice at this particular time. Now, the elections went through were really strange. And the period since the election, in my opinion, has even been stranger. I've never seen, like, the corporate media spend 24/7 attacking the president. You know, why is that? What's going on? Well, it's clear that he was not the person that they wanted. But you know, this is what they're doing. Where does it come from? What does it mean? What does these strange politics mean? Well, first of all, the one point where they didn't attack him was when he went to war.
Yes.
And he has increased the wars. He has escalated the wars. We heard of the troops on the ground in Yemen. We heard the introduction of more troops in Syria, the introduction of more troops in Iraq, the recent bombing of Syrian troops by the U.S. Military, many, many civilian deaths around Mosul that have been caused by U.S. bombing. The dropping of the mother of all bombs in Afghanistan. However, the real scary thing, in my opinion, is the escalation that's going on with the Democratic Republic North Korea. The media, just like they can say something, media can say, all right, Hillary didn't really lose. Well, we know she got a couple of extra votes, and it was the Electoral College. Hillary didn't really lose. It was those Russians. I challenge someone to show me one piece of evidence they said that they showed to indicate that the Russians did this stuff. WikiLeaks said, no, they didn't get it from the Russians. It was not a hacking that went on of the Democratic National Committee, but it was a leak from the Democratic National Committee that happened, because there was someone who was not very happy with the way they were not playing fair with Bernie Sanders. And they were not playing fair with Bernie Sanders. Bernie Sanders does not have a great position on the wars or Palestine or these other things, but they were not playing fair. I remember watching CNN during the California primaries, and Hillary Clinton had a rally, and it had a couple of hundred people. They covered it word for word. At the same time, Sanders had a rally, and it had 40,000 people at it. And they mentioned that he had a rally. That's all they did. If they were going to defeat Trump, they needed to build the kind of enthusiasm that Bernie was building, regardless of what you think of his politics, that he was building among youth. And when they undercut him, what happened is those youths went home. There were more people who were eligible to vote in the last election who did not vote than there were people that voted for either of those two candidates. Hillary Clinton, they said, had the worst approval rating of any
presidential candidate that ever existed in the history of presidential candidates in the United States, with the exception of Donald Trump. So somehow our lesser evil politics, our two-party politics, got us the two worst people we could imagine. And then they gave us that as a choice. Well, people said that was not a choice, and it was not a choice. And they tried to say, well, she really won, you know, it was these Russians. And Margaret showed me this, Margaret Kimberly. Here's Time Magazine. They have this cynical looking Putin. I know you can't see it from far away, so I'll have to explain this, but you can come up and take a look. And it says, the Russians want to undermine faith in the U.S. In the U.S. elections. Don't fall for it. Well, Margaret found another Time magazine.
Yeah.
This is this, in their early 90s. And the lead, it says there, is the secret story of how American advisors helped Yeltsin win.
Yeah.
This led to the fall of the Soviet Union. Yeah. The United States has intervened into the elections of just about every country.
Yes.
It creates opposition parties when it doesn't like the party that's in there. It gives them propaganda and gives them money. It does economic sanctions against the government in power so people will turn against it. This is what we're seeing going on in Venezuela in a real serious way at a very critical time, that we all have to come behind Venezuela right now. And if that doesn't work, they do a coup. They do it over and over, and they've done it throughout the world. And if that doesn't work, they send in the military and do regime change. And that's what these wars are about all over the world that the United States is involved in. And they're trying to say, oh, this guy's bad, this guy's bad, this guy's bad. Yeah, there's a lot of bad guys in this world. But the real bad guys are the ones whose country we live in. We have around military bases in around 130 countries. We have around 20 times the number of foreign military bases as all other countries in the world combined. The U.S. is the cause for war. We have to be clear on that. We have to oppose U.S. wherever they are. They will always say it for humanitarian reasons. They will always say that to try to get the population behind them, but we have to oppose them. So now we've got this stuff going on with North Korea. How many countries since the Korean War has North Korea attacked? Let me give you a hint. It's zero. How many has the United States attacked since then? Well, there's Vietnam, there was Cambodia, there was Laos, there was Cuba, remember the Bay of Pigs, Iraq, Afghanistan. I don't have enough fingers to go through all of that to tell you the truth. And yet, we're, in the United States, the biggest military power in the world, are supposed to be afraid of North Korea. During the Korean War, we killed about one-third of the population of that country. We bombed just about every building that stood. And when that was done and there was not much to bomb, we started bombing their dams to try to flood the people of Korea. That is a war crime. And the United States did it. It's done war crimes over and over and over again in the history of this world. And yet, why should they fear us? Twice they offered treaties to the United States. Those treaties were that they would stop their nuclear development if we would stop our threats against them. They stopped their nuclear development. We did not stop the threats against them. So they continued their nuclear development. We have war games right on the borders twice a year. The last one had 250,000 people in that war games with planes that flew over that were armed with nuclear weapons. Should they be fearing us, or are we fearing them? We put THAAD missiles in South Korea. But North Korea is different than Iraq and Afghanistan. First of all, there's a tie to China. North Korea and China are nuclear powers. These aren't small armies like we've attacked and have not been able to win, even in Afghanistan, one of the poorest countries in the world. And Russia, too, is a nuclear power. And we're surrounding Russia on all sides. I was just over at the NATO conference in Europe, U.S. anti-war movement. Me and Anne Wright represent the U.S. anti-war movement. I want to mention the Black Hawk Down. She was involved in Black Hawk Down on the wrong side of that issue. She was in the U.S. side trying to stop the people then. But little by little, her conscience was eating away at her. And during the Iraq War, she was the ambassador to Mongolia. And she said, I had enough. Fuck this. She quit. She thought she wasn't going to even be able to get a pension. She didn't care. She was able to get a pension. And she's been one of the most consistent anti-war activists ever since. We went to Iraq. But we are surrounding Russia. But we are threatened by Russia. They interfere in our elections. The United States is the power that threatens everybody around the world. And we have to put an end to it. And it's a power. And these wars are bipartisan wars. We have to understand that. We have to have an independent anti-war movement. I encourage you all to join that movement. UNAC, as I mentioned, has a conference coming up in 2 weeks. We have a mailing list there. Please sign it. Please join us. The issues of war are not going away. They are only increasing. War is a permanent part of politics in this country and this world today, and it all stems from Washington and Wall Street. Thank you. So we have some questions, discussion. Raise your hand.